What you're going to hear today is simply a couple of what I would call sphere punks. I'm not even trying to give you the top of it, all the points, the significant points. I'm only hitting a couple of things. In 1996 and other times when I had warned there was going to be a catastrophic terrorist attack on the United States, and one of those warnings was published in the Nashville Banner. I knew at the time that people would regard me as an alarmist. But of course I was vindicated by 9/11. That's not the kind of way you want to be vindicated, but it was showing that all the indicators were there. This was not about prophecy. This was about studying and paying attention to what's going on in our world. Not a knee-jerk opinion. And what I'm going to say to you and what I've said in Into the Night is not a knee-jerk opinion. This is based on 2,000 plus years of history. And quite frankly, we're going through something that 24 plus civilizations have gone through before. And yet we think of ourselves as superior, as somehow above all of that. Normally, I would reject the notion of statistics. Because I believe if I have to use statistics to tell an audience or convince an audience that the trouble of the nation is severe, I'm wasting my time. That audience is not hearing anyway. But I'm going to use these more as an illustration of something. We have, as I understand it right now, approximately a $17 trillion debt, largest debt in the history of the world. Our non-married households now exceed 52%. And by the way, these are from the New York Times, not a conservative newspaper. The out-of-wedlock births in our culture now exceed 40%. Illegal drugs are used by projection regularly by 22 million Americans. 22 million Americans feel a need to stick a needle in their arm, sniff something up their nose, gulp something down their throat in order to somehow find life more tolerable. Pornography is now a $10 billion a year plus industry. It is higher in revenues than all the major sports industries combined, all of them. The number of children who are sexually molested in this country, and I'm personally interested in this because once as a young lawyer for the state of Tennessee, I had to deal with this issue, protecting children. The experts estimate, based on what we know, that at any given day, there are 3 million American children who are subjected to some form of sexual abuse. Sexual abuse. There are 39 million adults who say, I was sexually molested as a child. Our prison population, and this is always a shocker to many Americans, we have the largest prison population in the world. It's larger than Russia, it's larger than China, it's larger than India. And yet all of those are much larger than we are. And I point out that prison population is not a percentage of our population, that is in literal numbers. We have 2.3 million people behind bars in the good old USA. Aborticide, and by the way, I never use the term abortion. An abortion is a broad generic term to the death of an unborn child that can come about from natural circumstances. What we're talking about is aborticide, the deliberate, conscious killing of an unborn child. Aborticide is something that I think that most Americans, because they don't experience it, they don't see it closely, they don't recognize the significance of this, that 50 million of our unborn children have been chosen to be disposed of. Homosexual marriage. Now, to me, the significance of that is not necessarily the fact that people would choose that kind of lifestyle. The point I want to make to you is the fact that now, for the first time in history, part of the legacy of a great nation is going to be this concept of homosexual marriage enshrined in the nation's laws. And then one other point that I think is very significant. One half of 1% of this population are defending us. They're doing the killing and the dying. One half of 1% is carrying that entire load for 300 million Americans. most American Christians especially don't realize that we're swimming, I would say a backstroke, through a cultural, sociological, and historical cesspool in terms of morality, dysfunction, and illogical ideas and behavior. Why is that? Why do we Christians not seem to be so conscious of this? I think it's because for most Christians, their lives are satisfactory to them. They feel largely untouched by all of these things. They're making a good living. They live in a comfortable home. They're working on building a retirement portfolio. They get to engage in the sports and the entertainment and the pleasures. And they feel no great threat to themselves or to their loved ones. But I'm here to warn you, both from personal experience and from the lessons of history, hell, figuratively or literally, is never more than a millimeter or a moment away for any one of us. Some of you may have already had to deal with that. You thought your life was very comfortable. You were secure. And then all of a sudden it came down on you with great force. And you had pain and you had fear and you had grief. That's part of the problem with American Christians. We choose to seek out this cocoon, build it around us, and not look out beyond it. And therefore we never know, we never recognize how close even we can be. But all of the credible evidence, objective evidence, not opinion, points to imminent tragedy in this nation. In fact, it's already taking place. It's just that most people aren't paying attention. All right, how do you understand this? How do you get your mind around it? Well, the first thing you have to consider is, what is this nation built on? What is the belief system or whatever that we have traditionally adhered to? And the significant thing about this point, I call it the superstructure of Western civilization. The significant thing about this point is that even the agnostic sociologists and historians subscribe to this view. I was struck by one of them who said, if you're born in America and you're raised in America, you're a Christian. And of course, he didn't mean by that you'd made a faith commitment. He just meant that you didn't realize how much of your life was dominated by the teachings of Christ, those principles, those values. Now, what happens, though, if that changes, if that's removed? Let's look at it this way. I would say to you that for most of our history, overwhelmingly, Jesus Christ was the philosophical father of our civilization and our nation, even if you weren't a Christian. But who would you guess might be the philosophical father today? I believe it was Pontius Pilate. In his rhetorical question, which really was a statement of opinion, what is truth? Pilate was giving voice to this notion that there is no absolute truth, that this is a matter of personal choice. And this is what you see behind everything that's going on in the culture. There is no absolute standard. That contradicts, of course, everything Christ taught. Now, the question you then have to ask yourself, if this is true, Christianity is a superstructure of Western civilization. Why is it then that with all the advantages we Christians and our churches had in the 20th century, do we find ourselves in this predicament? With a culture in this condition? With a dramatic loss in our influence in the culture? And frankly, many are already expecting persecution, and it will come, and it'll become more and more obvious. But there's something else that most people as Christians don't even think about. And it was summed up to me, strangely enough, by a young officer who'd just come out of Afghanistan. I was having lunch with him a few months ago. I already had a sense of this, but I had to hear this from him. Here's a young man in his mid-20s, and I said to him, Ian, based on all this interaction with young people of your age, how do you believe most young people in America today of your age category feel about Christianity and the church? He didn't hesitate. He said, Mr. Scarborough, most of them regard it as irrelevant to their lives. Now that is in fact supported by George Barna surveys. Over the last many years, we've gone from 80+% Americans saying that their faith commitment was important to them to less than 10% now. And a lot of Christians do not understand the significance and the gravity of that. Now you have to ask the question, was this moral and spiritual decline beyond our control as Christians and Christian churches? Well, the only honest answer to that is no. Certainly was not. I would say to you unequivocally, the church, speaking broadly of all of us who are professing Christians, has been deceived. We've been heavily influenced over the generations by the culture. We tended not to see this as in any way a hazard or a danger. The culture was supposedly submissive to the Christian view anyway. Nonetheless, we continued in that pattern. We became such that, in fact, in time, we were pulled into orbit around the culture. If you examine the practices and the beliefs of most Christians today, you will find more that's of the world, I believe, than it's truly of Christ. Instead of pulling our culture and our nation into orbit around Jesus Christ and His beliefs and His teachings, we've allowed ourselves to be pulled into orbit around this culture. Now, this led, of course, to inevitably to compromise with the culture, to trying to accommodate its beliefs and its expectations. This, in turn, has led to the corruption of the church. Now, before I make the next point, you need to hear this. Two of the great writers on decay and decline were Peterim Sorokin, a Russian sociologist who came here to this country and founded the first school of sociology at Harvard, and Arnold Toynbee, the great British historian. They both said the same thing. They said one of the major features of a culture in decay and decline is this tendency toward trying to absorb and inculcate and accommodate values, beliefs, and ideas that are fundamentally in conflict with one another. They can't fit. It's not logically possible. But these cultures try to make it work. The individuals themselves try to absorb them. Classic illustration, one of the most obvious, is this notion, well, Christianity and Islam are just two different ways to God. Neither of the founders of those faiths would say that. Just the opposite. It is not logically possible when you study those two religions to come to that conclusion. It's irrational. But it's a fashionable way to see things in this culture. They had a name for it. Sorokin called this concept chaotic syncretism. Toynbee called it pamixia. But it's critical to understand. When people start to try to force themselves into believing something that even isn't logically possible, what does that tell you? Now, this compromise with the culture and the corruption that followed has been so pervasive for so long and is so common that we in the Christian churches do not even recognize it for what it is. In fact, we treat much of it as some form of success. We have, for example, this romance with numbers in the church. I was raised the son of a Baptist minister, and among Baptists, at least even today, it's still, oh, how many more have you added? The romance with numbers focuses on the numbers on the roll, the dollars raised and in the budget, and the number of buildings and square footage you either have or you built. None of that has anything to do with the teachings of Jesus Christ. Ruth Graham, that wonderful grand lady, said something that I wish was emblazoned over the doorway of every Christian church in America, and I mean that broadly and generically, every denomination. She said, God does not work through buildings which crumble and fall, but only through changed lives which last for an eternity. And you remember, too, when Jesus was asked by the rich young ruler, what must I do to be able to follow you? Jesus said to him, go and sell all that you have and give the money to the poor, and then you can come and follow me. Jesus, of course, had already picked out. He perceived this young man's weakness. That was a bridge too far. He was not going to go that far. Most Christians are trying to confine Christ to the parameters they want him in. And this is the result of why we're so weak in the church. Don't ask me to go that route. Don't ask me to make that kind of sacrifice. But that's what he calls for. If we had the same situation happen, some prestigious young man of great wealth and stature come into the typical American church today and want to become a member, I would predict that in most of them, people would probably fall over themselves to try to make sure he joined. The rationale behind that would be, well, just look at how we can serve God with his money, all the ministries and programs that we can develop. In taking that attitude, we are not only being disobedient to Christ, we're doing a terrible disservice to the young man who needs to hear the truth, that his money does him no good. But money is one of the fixations even among us Christians. The correct measures of spiritual success are very clear from the teachings of Christ. There's only two of them. Change lives and a culture headed in a completely different direction from where ours is going. When you look at it that way, can anybody possibly make the argument that we in the church in America have been successful? Indeed, it's just the opposite. We failed. Martin Luther, in his time, had to deal with corruption in a similar type in the church. And one of the paramount features of this was something called an indulgence. It was nothing more than a document signed by a priest or a bishop. Somebody had given a certain amount of money to the church. The priest or bishop signs this, and it says, in essence, you, your loved one, whatever, will not be in purgatory. You won't go to hell. You'll go to heaven because of your donation to the church. Now, we American 21st century Christians, we look at that and we have an almost pompous attitude. How can anybody be so foolish and so gullible as to believe that? But for those of you who are professing Christians, the American church across the board is selling self-indulgence. And it's just as foolish, it's just as out of touch with what Jesus actually said. We are in a situation today in which we want to please and be pleased. But this was not what Christ was all about. Jesus Christ was not part of the culture. He was the most countercultural figure in all of history. And he often spoke of the need for us to be separate and apart. Famous words from Luke, where Christ said, "You are the ones who justify yourselves in the eyes of men, but God knows your hearts. What is highly valued among men is detestable in God's sight." Now, this theme of deception is critical for individuals and for us today in the church. Billy Graham said just prior to the last presidential election, he made a public statement, and his timing was obvious, the paramount theme of which is, Americans are deceived. He really emphasized that. American Christians are deceived. One of the things I've learned painfully from personal experience as a lawyer and for friends and so forth, all human degradation has a major component of deceit. It may be simply the self-deceit that some of us engage in with some sinful conduct, but it's going to be there. And this, in fact, is part of the historical record too. Deceit is always part of what brings any individual or any culture down. This relates to something Paul said in Timothy, 2 Timothy. "For the time will come when men will not put up with sound doctrine, but they'll gather around them a great number of teachers to say what their itching ears want to hear. And they'll turn away from the truth and they'll turn to myths." Now, I believe the evidence is overwhelming that the American church, that time arrived a long time ago, and it's only gotten worse over the passage of years. We are too often in the church as Christians, we only want to listen to those who say the things that we'll accept and we're welcoming, and we avoid those who say what we don't want to hear, what we do not want to accept. The whole notion of what Jesus called for, absolute surrender of everything, that's alien to the typical American. You don't even really hear it in the pulpit if you listen. Now, this deception relates to the state of our nation. Where do we Christians think all of this decay and decline is coming from? Somebody can answer that. I'm serious. I'd like to know. What do you think most Christians perceive as the source or sources of the forces that are causing this culture to go morally and spiritually down the tube? This Niagara has multiple sources. This Niagara of this sort of sewer, but Christians never humble themselves enough to consider that perhaps we are the greatest obstacle to saving America and to saving individual members of our society. They never think. Maybe the major problem here is not out there. which is something we all love to do. Blame it on somebody else. Maybe the problem's not out there, but it's somehow associated with me, my church, me individually. The deception in the personal lives of Christians is really unsettling. These two points I'm going to make next, in my judgment, are so telling of the gulf between Jesus Christ and what he taught and what Christians actually live and practice. The first one is the Christian obsession with materialism, money, possessions. How are we significantly different from the rest of the culture in the pursuit of wealth and things? You may think we are in that respect, but I don't see the evidence of it. And I don't think the secular part of our world sees it either. Second thing is the pleasure that we turn to, the entertainment, the sports. And yet in television and movies and video and so forth, so much of this today, this is so debased and perverse. You don't have to be a Christian to see it. You don't even have to be a moralist. You have to just not be a blind fool. But there is a blindness here. By the way, Sorokin said about this, that when a culture starts using human pathologies, this kind of behavior, as entertainment, that is a sure and certain indicator that the culture itself is pathologically sick. I want to give you an illustration of something that happened a few years ago with the Super Bowl. This particular day, one side won, I don't even remember who it was, and there was all this panoply of talk and so forth that went on for days and days afterwards about the heroic performance of the players. They were feted, everything was done to elevate them as heroes. That term was used, heroes. In my hometown of Jackson, Tennessee, the winning quarterback was treated like he had just won the war in Iraq. I was disgusted by it, and I'll tell you one of the primary reasons I was. The same day of that Super Bowl, and this was shown in the news, but it was given scant treatment. There was a special operations team that kicked in the door of an Al-Qaeda safe house, a terror cell in Iraq. This particular cell had a specialty. They would develop some form of explosive, C4 or something, strap it to women who were mentally ill or mentally retarded, send them into crowds, and then detonate it, and of course killing multiple people. First two men through the door were SEALs named Koch and Hatfield, and they were both shot in the head and killed. That was in the news the same day, same 24-hour interval as the Super Bowl. Not a person in America today knows those two SEALs' names. But I guarantee you, most of the Christians know the names of the winning quarterback. In fact, some of them were sitting at probably a Super Bowl party in their church the day that that happened. What does that tell you about our culture? What does it tell you about us Christians? We haven't even got the good sense to understand what's critical to our survival. Who should we be holding up as heroic? That 0.5% Not these people who have an ability to run a ball across a line or throw it through a hoop or knock a little white ball in the hole in the ground. All of this, again, is deception. But the next level of deception is the one that concerns me most about us Christians. And that is the absence of significant evidence of true sacrificial love of the type that Christ talked about and modeled. If there's one concern that I have for us Christians, and I think is the worst failure, the most despicable, the most shameful, it is this one. Within the range of virtually anybody's church in this audience, there are going to be people who desperately need what Jesus Christ would have had to offer, or they'll need some relief from some form of suffering, something that they're enduring. But they're not going to go into the doors of your church. Now, granted, some of them won't do it because they're afraid of some accountability that they don't want to face there. But I would tell you that the majority of them won't go through the doors of any church because, number one, they don't believe anybody there is really going to care. And number two, they'll equally be convinced nobody there will be able to help them anyway. They don't know how. Now, the result of this is we got millions of Americans within just a speaking range of the doors of most of our churches, and all they've got to look forward to build their lives on, is the American culture's concept of happiness and meaning. They're building their whole image of life and what it should be by watching the media. Now, the The fact that this is the case is so concerning. A good Samaritan is a classic illustration. Jesus talked about the priests and the Levites who went by on the other side. Well, we Christians are driving by in our SUVs way off the road. We have left to government what God intended us to do. And the result of that is that government does poorly what we Christians won't do at all. And the consequence of that is that millions of people who are suffering and in need never have the benefit of Christ-like love or hearing about the values of Jesus Christ. We take this deception in regard to government even a little bit further, and I've really been sensitive about this because I've been inside the political arena and, of course, as a lawyer. So many Christians, and I know them, they're looking for politics and government somehow to resolve it. They're looking, really what they're looking for is somebody to rescue them. Send this guy to Washington, he'll straighten this mess out. And of course, that's what he or she promises. How many times have you heard that lately? Send me to Washington, I'll straighten this mess out. I'll turn this nation around. But politics, government, and law, folks, is about power. I can tell you, I've been on the inside of all of them. It's the imposition of power by people who have it on those who do not or who cannot fight it. It's not about changing the human mind and heart. And that's what Christ was all about. You cannot fix this through politics, government, and law. I'll even go so far as to say it really bluntly. No politician, no political party, no constitution, no ideology can save America. It is impossible. Now we take this deception even further into the teaching and belief. One of the things I often cringe about now is when I hear somebody say, well, we just need to pray more for our nation. Now that's certainly true. There is no way I'm going to stand here and not try to do anything other than confess my failure to pray like I should. But I know what's behind most of that. Most of it is simply nothing more than a rationalization. It's a spiritual way of sounding like you're doing what you should be doing. That's not what the Bible teaches. The only thing that's going to happen there is you're just going to get calluses on your knees. And then we got the question of fear. My goodness, how many Christians are afraid? Unwilling to speak about what they believe in the most obvious places. And they're unwilling also to speak forcefully when they're confronted with an issue they know they should challenge. And why would anybody want to listen to us then? The result of this deception are these consequences. First of all, American Christians are often so spiritually weak. Secondly, the American church in all of its iterations is very frequently very ineffectual. The next point is that non-Christians don't take us seriously. I can tell you that the people outside the realm in which we tend to live, especially here in the Bible Belt, they look at us and by and large their attitude is, there's nothing significantly different about these people other than that they're self-righteous. They like to look down their noses on us and tell us what to do. Now the question then we obviously come to, can anything be done about this? Oh yes. But you need to hear this first. Toynbee said, politics, war, economics, revolution, all this that we pay attention to in the media, that we pay so much attention to even in our history books, he said is all on the surface of the stream of history. This is not the significant part. Toynbee said the significance of history are in the deep currents below, and those are summed up in one thing, the closely held values and beliefs of the individual. Those are the things that you and I actually believe, that we actually value, and that we make our decisions on, even if we're hypocritically telling other people that it's something else. Now, what does this tell us? Toynbee's right, and I'm absolutely certain he is. It tells us that the world can only be changed by changing the human heart. And what was Jesus Christ in the business of? And what are we supposed to be in the business of? Edmund Burke made that famous supposedly statement, the only thing necessary for evil to triumph is for good men to do nothing. I stand with Dietrich Bonhoeffer, who paid with his life when he said, in essence, good men don't do nothing. But there are millions of Christians who are trying to live under the umbrella of Burke's principle. Well, I hadn't had anything to do with this. But they're watching it go by. They're watching the suffering. And they haven't done anything, and then they want to think of themselves as good. One thing that I have noticed in my personal life and in the study of history, Evil is never so smart, so clever, so powerful to triumph. Good is always all of those things much more. The only way evil ever triumphs is because of the weakness of the good or those who profess to be good. And that's what we're seeing in our culture. Words of alarm are being said about this. Some of you may be thinking, well, Ivy, I've heard some of this before. But I'm going to ask you honestly, have you ever heard it with such intensity or passion? I hear so many preachers even sometimes who will preach on this, and it's like listening to somebody talk in a monotone about how that house is burning down. There are children in there who may die. Somebody ought to do something. That's where we are. Christians are thinking about this sometimes, but here's what they seem to be thinking. Well, first of all, this probably can be done, but it's not going to require a big sacrifice from me. Some of them are thinking, well, the rapture of the apocalypse is going to rescue me. Others are thinking, well, I'll be dead before this all hits at the worst anyway. What about your children and your grandchildren? Then there are the incurable optimists. God won't let this happen. And then there are others, a multitude of these, they're going to oppose something. They see something that needs to be opposed. And there are so many things that need to be. But that, what has opposition done for us? Has that changed anything? Our strategy, if you could call it that, fellow Christians, has failed. And it was doomed to fail because it was not the strategy given to us by Christ. This is of the world. We're fighting a rear guard defensive action to try to salvage our influence in this culture. And the problem here is it's no different in Jeremiah's time. You remember the classic line about, is there no bomb in Gilead? The answer's right before us, but we're not looking to that. God's not going to rescue America. It will not happen. The only way this is going to occur is there's a reformation in the thinking and the hearts of the American Christians to the point that they're saying, in essence, I'm going to be obedient completely. I'm going to pay attention to what Christ said and what he taught, and I'm going to honor that. Not what any preacher, what any theologian, what any denomination says. And I know it's going to cost me to do it. It will, certainly. There are innumerable pastors and Christian leaders who have never even come close to getting down in the sense of humility and asking themselves the question, have I failed? Is this partly my fault? I had a man say to me after hearing me preach one Sunday, he was a decorated veteran. He came up to me and he whispered in my ear and he had tears in his eyes and he said, Mr. Scarborough, I know in my heart of hearts that what you said here today is true, but I never believed I'd live long enough to hear it preached from any pulpit. That's shameful. Now, I've got one point of good news to close this thing. Only one. And I call it the Gideon principle. Nowhere in Scripture do you see God make dramatic changes in human experience, in human life, and in history, except through one committed individual, or what the Bible refers to as a faithful remnant. God does not work through mass numbers. That's the thinking of the American church. This thing can be dramatically changed by just a few faithful Christians saying, I'm going to surrender. I'm going to do it God's way. And I got to tell you, so many of you are baby boomers like me. Our generation does not have a good reputation. We have one last opportunity to redeem ourselves before we end up just being carcasses sitting out in some cemetery somewhere. To be able to say, this generation did something dramatic. It turned the culture around. There are things I wish I could tell you, but I don't have the time. There are things I could tell you that are of the positive nature of what I can see would happen if just a small number of American Christians made that choice. I'm going to surrender, I'm going to obey completely, and I'm going to make the sacrifices and act courageously as Christ called for. It would be an exalted experience. I don't have time, so all I can say to you is this. The future of your family, your children, your nation, and your relationship with God hangs on the choice that you make.